everything in, oh well, not everything, but a great part of simple therapy, for as far as I understand, is based on asking to the client what is the most important question,
most useful
yes. question for him or for her. It's very interesting because during the your presentation, your Mboyan presentation in Sofia, you say that this is different from traditional therapy, in which
yes.
clients asks and the therapist has the answer, and is also different from solution focus in a way, because
yes.
In solution focus, therapist ask and clients give the answer.
Exactly.
And in simple therapy, it's also different.
Yes. The difference, as we see it, is really a kind of second order change. It is not a change in what we ask. Before, because all previous ways of doing therapy are different among themselves in only one respect: the bunch of questions they are interested in. For example, psychoanalysts are very much interested in the question why. They are asking about your dreams. They are asking about early childhood, and they are very careful about the mistakes that you do in your language. If you are a Jungian therapist, you will be very interested in synchronicities, in all kinds of images that can be attributed to archetypes. Whenever the client mentions a tree or river or leader or something, they start thinking right away about archetypes and things like that. Solution-focused brief therapists are no different. They believe that their questions are more useful to clients than the questions of other approaches. But they use exactly the same pattern. We therapists, have a number of issues. We have an agenda. And in solution-focused brief therapy, this is the future or next steps or miracles nowadays, best hopes, things like that. But this is not the client's agenda. It is the therapist's agenda. And this is what we try to change, which is a real change from all traditional kinds of therapy, including solution-focused therapy, because we think that it is the client's questions that matter. And something that we have discovered, if we have discovered anything, is that there are no good and bad questions. For example, many solution-focused therapists believe that the miracle question is much better then the question why. We do not agree with that, because there is a time for clients to ask the question why, and a time to ask the question about miracles. There was this classical example of a Finnish in Finland, a therapist who asked the miracle question, and the client just didn't answer, and the therapist asked it 4 times in a row. And then somebody from behind the mirror said, ask her how many sessions she needs to tell you her story. And the therapist went back and asked the client, how much time do you need to tell me? And did you hear my question? And the client said, yes, I heard it. 4 times you asked him the same question. But I want to tell you really about what I want to tell you. So the client asked, how long is one session? The therapist said 40, 50 minutes, and the client said, I need 4 sessions. And by the middle of the 4th session, the client said, and now I want to answer your question that you asked me 4 sessions ago. So it is the timing which decides what question is useful and what is not useful. There are no good and bad questions. This idea that our questions are better than the other approach's questions is just an illusion. Each and every question can be useful. It is asked on time. And that's the reason why we don't use our questions, because our questions may happen to be on time. It is the client's time. It is the client's timeline. but they may also happen to be out of time. Well, their questions are always on time, because they ask them. And the second advantage of their questions is that they are stated in their own language, so they understand. If I ask a question, each and every word that I say or you say may be misunderstood by the other person. Well, clients usually understand what they ask. If they don't understand, if they misunderstand themselves, Professor Gail Muir from Milwaukee, who is very much with us in this, says it is a kind of a discovery. People discover new meanings when they misunderstand their own questions or answers. And then another advantage is that the more clients practice the art of asking useful questions, the better they become in this process. Mm-hmm. In this way, we help them not only find solutions for their present situation. I like Thomas Švitek's idea about situations because it's again non-pathological. Just like if we say we meet people with questions, this is the most non-pathological way to look at people. So the more they practice, the more prepared they are for future troubles and hard times. Because we believe that therapy is nothing more than assisted self-help. That's what it is. And if clients are capable of asking useful questions, then they don't need therapists. But sometimes we people, we humans, we need somebody else to ask me a question because it is not the same question anymore. Imagine that I have a question asking myself. If you ask this question to me, then I have to answer not only the question, I have to answer Flavio too. And it makes the question very different. It is very useful for clients to hear their own questions from somebody else. I think that this is the best way to validate them, to empower them, to give them the power over the course of the conversation. And this is the most, the best way for us to respect our clients. Because each and every question that the therapist has the implicit meaning. Because you are unable to state a useful question yourself, so you are kind of a fool or an idiot compared to me. I shall ask you right now this wonderful, almost genius question that will let you live as happy as can be. And we don't agree with that. We want the client to be above us. And then the miracle that Steve DeShazer was talking about in Ginsu, it happens within the therapy room in front of our very eyes, not tonight, not while we are sleeping. You can see clients becoming very vivid, very interested, laughing. And of course, you have to expect the first moment they hear this question, what do you think is the most useful question that we can talk about? Many will say, I don't know. Because they have never been given the possibility to do it. So we have to wait there and to support them in this and to give them time to think and then come up with what. Every time they say, I don't know, I hear, I don't know now. And I tell them, okay, for the time being, I shall ask you my professional questions, but this is my second choice. Clients need to remember and to be aware all the time that their questions have a high, high, high priority over anything else that the therapist may talk about. And I think this is really a radical change, and it is a part of the difficulty. We proposed this 11 years ago at the EBTA conference back in Lyon in 2008. So for 11 years, it is public, but we have done it for 15 years or so. And I have never met a client who will resist this or who doesn't like it. But I have met many therapists who say, no, we don't like yeah. this. And part of it is because they're afraid that they will lose control over the course of the conversation. They're afraid that clients may go to endless problem talk, yeah. for example. Such a thing does not exist. If we ask them about the most useful question, this has nothing to do with psychoanalytical free associations. We set a very, very rigid, tight framework for them to think. I want from you not any question that comes to your mind, nothing like that. Because our conversation needs to be useful for you, I want you to come up with the most useful question right now. And because it is the time that matters, I usually look at the clock on the wall and tell them, now at 11:15, what do you think is the most useful question for you? And I can tell that people change. And with every next question, they become better and better. And sometimes therapy is not only single session. It may happen to be single yeah. question if their first question is a very good one.
Yeah.
And therapy can last 10 minutes or 15 minutes. But actually, we are not interested to tell the truth about the quantity of time. One session, two, five. I'm totally disinterested in this. We think about the quality of the conversation. And the quality is high whenever they have something to buy from us. That's why we get paid. They have to buy some idea, some useful things to do or to
yeah.
search for, look for, so on.